Hello and welcome to The Vote here at Latest TV. I'm Mike Mendoza. Today I'm joined by Matt Wilson. Matt is with the Mutual Aid in Sussex. Welcome to you, sir.
Thank you.
Nice to see you.
Thanks for having me.
What is Mutual Aid? What is this all about?
Mutual Aid is the idea that we should try and cooperate and help each other rather than follow this idea of competing all the time. So it's a broad principle that's a big part of the cooperative movement, but a part of other movements as well.
You've got an event on the 11th of June, that's Saturday 11th of June, at the Synergy Centre in West Street, that's 78 West Street. This is all about cooperative alternatives for work, for housing, energy, food, and a lot more. How's this going to work? What is that all about?
Well, the idea of putting on the event was to promote cooperatives and more broadly cooperation. It was originally an idea that Mutual Aid in Sussex had, and we've been joined by the Free University of Brighton, so we've been co-organising it with them. The event's going to have two streams of workshops, so it's for a wide range of people, really. It's for people who don't really know that much about cooperatives, who want to learn a bit more, or maybe they're thinking about setting up a co-op. There'll be lots of help and advice for people who planning to set up a co-op, a housing co-op or a workers' co-op.
So anyone can set up a co-op?
Yep, anyone can do it. So we'll be there helping people and inspiring people, hopefully, that's a way they might want to think about doing things. And we also want to use the event to help facilitate more communication and more mutual aid within existing co-ops and existing organisations, mm-hmm. people to get to know each other, and find out ways that they can and help each other and work together.
Do co-ops normally work together?
Well, it's one of the... So the cooperative movement has seven principles, and principle six of the cooperative movement is mutual aid, that they should help each other as well as being cooperative within themselves, that they should be cooperative with each other. But sadly, I think mostly for pragmatic reasons, that doesn't happen as much as we'd like it to happen. And I think probably lots of people in co-ops would feel the same. And that's one of the reasons why we set up Mutual Aid in Sussex, was to try and help people do that, to try and facilitate it. Obviously, if you're in a co-op and you're, especially if it's a workers' co-op and it's a business, you spend so much time on the business itself, it can sometimes feel hard to kind of step out. But the mm-hmm. idea of mutual aid is you get back what you give, you know, that you're helping other people, but in turn you're being helped yourself.
It is a bit like the original communist system.
Not necessarily. I mean, the cooperative movement has links with quite a diverse range of political movements. So also the Labour movement, but also the right as well. I mean, obviously you've heard David Cameron talking about cooperatives. So depending on how you approach cooperatives, it can work in a diverse political setting, I think. Mm. But it's certainly not... certainly the cooperative movement that I'm part of and that I would support isn't a fan of state communism, definitely not.
Okay, well, what are the main advantages to using this?
To using cooperation,
yeah.
I think it's a nicer way to work. I think we're very used to this idea that we have a boss or we have a leader, and that some people, you know, race ahead and other people are stuck behind. And we've come to see that as being fairly natural, but I don't think it is, and I don't think it's a particularly nice way to work. I think, you know, if I was working with you, I'd rather we sit down and discuss how we're going to do something mm-hmm. rather than me just tell you or you tell me. And I think that empowers people and makes them feel better about their living situation or their working situation rather than being forced to do something. So I think it's a nicer way for humans to interact ultimately. And I think it's as efficient, if not more so, than having a hierarchical structure. I think it enables more compassion, more understanding between people because they have to communicate. You know, you can't just tell me you have to do this and that's the end of it. You'd say, well, I'd like to do this because, and you have to, you know, explain yourself. Yeah. So I think it leads to a much more open and compassionate and understanding society.
To justify the means, basically.
Yeah.
The cooperative we see now, like cooperative stores, is that run the same type of way?
Not really, no. So that's obviously what most people think of when they think of the cooperative movement. It was originally set up as a very genuine co-op. It came out of the Rochdale Pioneers in the 19th century. But over time, it's become a very distorted vision of what it was originally.
It's become business.
And certainly now, in recent years, it's not cooperative at all. It's been bought out by hedge funds, and so it's really lost its roots completely. Yeah.
So what's the way forward now? Are these sort of individual people setting up their own cooperatives?
Yeah, I mean, the co-op movement was huge in the 19th century, and throughout the 20th century it dwindled. But in the last 5 or 10 years, we've seen a real interest in co-ops again. I think particularly with the kind of economic crisis and austerity, and people starting to really question the fundamental principles of our economic system. People, you know, finally starting to say capitalism really isn't working. The way we're doing things isn't working. And so people are quite desperate, I think, for alternatives. And the mainstream media is still lagging far behind in presenting alternatives. But people on the street are crying out for it. And so we've seen a huge interest in cooperatives growing. More and more co-ops being set up, and a diverse range of co-ops. So in the last few years, you've seen lots and lots of energy co-ops, which is people collaborating, getting together to try and create energy supplies for themselves, food co-ops, people buying food in bulk and sharing it out, housing co-ops and workers co-ops. It's a really blossoming movement, and I think it's a really positive way to try and challenge the prevailing economic and political systems, but to do so in a positive, constructive way that's inspiring and that's instantly beneficial. It's not just, you know, this is a utopia we can reach in the future. It's happening now, and it's making people's.
Is this alternative to using cash? Is it an alternative way of making a living? Is an alternative way of staying away from the big conglomerates?
It's an alternative. I'd say it's an alternative way of living, an alternative set of values and principles. It's not necessarily an alternative to cash and the marketplace. We tend to conflate capitalism with the marketplace and with.
We've got to make a living, haven't we?
Yeah, you've got to make a living at the moment. So you still operate within the market, but it's following very different principles than kind of neoliberal capitalism. So it is, for me, a very powerful alternative to that. But it also goes beyond cash, and it's about relationships, alternatives to the way we relate to one another, alternatives to this idea that we're always in this kind of constant hierarchy. So I think it's a very profound alternative to the way we think about how we engage as human beings in society.
I wasn't aware that Brighton and Hove is one of the UK's top hotspots for cooperatives. I didn't realise that.
No, well, it doesn't feel like that, I have to say, at times. I think that's because, as I said, through the 20th century, the cooperative movement really did plummet, sadly. But certainly in the last couple of years, I mean, there was an event at Brighton University a couple of weeks ago to promote co-ops. There's an event in a couple of weeks at Sussex campus to promote co-ops. So it is really, it's growing, but it's growing all over the country as well. I mean, there's stuff going on all over. It's really, as I say, it's really inspiring. It's not just Brighton and Hove.
Looking at what we do have locally, for example, you've got Infinity Foods, the Bevy co-op pub.
Yeah.
I didn't realise it was a co-op pub, I knew it was a community pub.
Yeah.
So basically something that's a community could be a co-op.
It could be, yeah. I mean, co-ops can there's not just one model for the basic idea of the co-op. There's lots of different ways of structuring that. So you could have a small co-op where it's just a few members and they all kind of work together day to day. You can have much larger projects that are co-ops where you have day to day you have managerial positions, but everyone has a say in what those managers do. So the Bevy, I think, is run along those lines. The Cowley Club is a co-op with about 200 members. Magpie is a workers' co-op. Yeah, there's all different ways of structuring the basic idea of the cooperative.
So one of the event you're having on the 11th of June at the Synergy Centre, one of the alternatives is for work.
Yeah.
So how would you find alternative work?
Well, it's not necessarily doing something different. I mean, ideally people, when they set up a workers' co-op, would think about what their workers' co-op is going to do, would do something slightly different, wouldn't necessarily just do the, you know, follow just any old business principle.
We're going to come back to that, man. I'm sorry to stop you mid-flow there. I'm talking to Matt Wilson from Mutual Aid in Sussex. You're watching The Vote here at Latest TV. We'll be back after the break. Don't go away. Welcome back to The Vote here at Latest TV. My name is Mike Mendoza. I'm still joined by Matt Wilson. Matt is with Mutual Aid in Sussex. You haven't got a title at all, have you?
No. We try and stay clear of titles.
Okay. We're talking about the event you're holding on the 11th of June at the Synergy Centre at 78 West Street in Brighton. And I asked you before the break, though, about one of the things at the event is the alternative for work. And you started to explain that.
Yeah, so basically, if you want to set up a business, you can go the usual model. You can maybe get a partner or just do it yourself and then start to employ people. But you can do it in a cooperative way. You can set up a workers' co-op, and you could essentially do anything that anyone setting up a business wants to do. But you just, rather than being a boss and having employees, you bring people in.
Like a partnership.
It's basically like a partnership, mm-hmm. but with more than two people. I mean, the workers' co-op that I'm part of, there is actually only two of us. So in some ways, we're essentially just a partnership. But there's a very important part of the cooperative principle is opposed to the accumulation of wealth. So if I leave my co-op, I don't have any shares in the co-op.
Right.
The co-op actually owns itself. So it's a way of stopping people becoming incredibly rich, basically.
Yeah, yeah.
So day to day, my co-op is, yeah, effectively a partnership. But most co-ops would have more than two members. It's, you know, four, five, six, seven, however mm-hmm. many. And then they work together, they collaborate. Their decisions are made equally amongst everyone. Pay is decided. Not everyone will necessarily be paid the same. Some people might work longer hours, or their job might be more difficult or dangerous or stressful. People might decide that person deserves to be rewarded more, but that's a decision that everyone will take collectively.
Mm. It's funny you should say that, because I was reading that the co-op normally pays more than normal employer would pay.
Yeah, I think generally co-ops will try and pay their each other a decent living wage. Yeah.
As a matter of interest, how long have you been involved in the cooperative movement?
For about 10 years, yeah.
There's been many changes over those 10 years.
I think, well, certainly, as I said earlier, the interest in the cooperative movement has grown massively in the last 10 years.
Is it mainly from young people?
There's a huge interest in younger people now. There's a project called AltGen, which was set up a few years ago, I think, and that's really, really growing, and that's aimed specifically, I think, at the under 30s. Mm-hmm. As I said, there's been events on both universities in Brighton recently. So there's a massive interest in younger people. I think people, you know, people coming out of university or going into university, knowing that they're going to be in masses of debt, really starting to question the I guess the basic structure of our society. Thinking, you know, what is this about? You know, I'm going here to, I'm being told I have to do this to get a job, but I'm going to be in 30 grand's debt by the time I leave, mm-hmm. and then I might not even be able to get a job. So I think people, the economic hardship that people have been facing and seeing recently has really made people stop and question society on quite a deep level. But once we're established, once we've got a job, once we've got a mortgage and so on, it's harder to challenge those things. So I think the younger generation are in an ideal position, really, because they're seeing what we're all seeing. They're seeing, you know, financial difficulties. They're seeing people really question things, but they've also got that, you know, the the energy of youth, and they're not stuck in, you know, a job, or they're not stuck in a kind of a particular habit, so they've got that space really to stop and think, and, mm-hmm. and we're seeing that happen all over.
The you're almost talking like we're living in an ideal world, and you want it, you're going to get it.
I don't think it is an ideal world. I think it's a much better world potentially than the one we live in. I think the world we live in is incredibly unjust and cruel, and it's okay for some of us. Lots of us are very privileged and very lucky, but I think we tend to outsource the misery that our society creates mm-hmm. to people in other parts of the world. And I think if we really took heed of that and paid attention to that, I think we'd have very, very bad nightmares at night. I think our society is a very, very problematic one, socially in terms of the costs of other human beings, but also, you know, we're well aware now of the environmental cost of the way we live. I don't think the co-operative alternative or any sort of alternative is ideal. I think, you know, human life is always going to be difficult. There's always going to be problems and conflict and unhappiness. But I think we could do a much, much better job than we are doing. And I think the lie that we've been told for a long time, that there's no alternative, is precisely that. It's a lie. And I think there is a much, much better way of doing things. Mm-hmm. And yeah, it's not a utopia, but it's...
Again, looking at your event on the 11th of June, a couple of topics there which really fascinate me. The alternative to housing, how's that work?
Well, so the idea of a housing co-op is that rather than having a landlord and renting from them, or rather than the usual
housing association?
Yeah, I mean, housing associations are a one way that sometimes they're co-ops and sometimes they're not. They don't have to be. But normally what would happen is a bunch of people would kind of club together and buy a house and then live in that house. And so they would all pay rent to pay off the mortgage. They would all make decisions about that house together. So you might have a couple of families living together. You might have, it tends to be younger people, but not always. And they're basically owning the house. But as I said before, they don't actually own the house in the conventional sense. So when they leave, they can't sell the house and make profits from it. But they own the house in the important sense that they're empowered, so that they can make decisions about what happens with that house. They don't have a landlord sitting above them telling them, no, you can't do this, or you have to do this. So yeah, it's just another way of taking back control, taking back ownership.
Mm-hmm. And what about alternatives for food?
Well, food co-ops, there's quite a few food co-ops in Brighton.
Is that like a food bank or something?
No. So the idea of a food co-op is people will chip together to buy, have a weekly or maybe a monthly delivery from someone like Infinity or Suma, both workers' co-ops, and you'll get a big load of food. It can be, you know, whatever food people are wanting, obviously, but one of the ideas behind it is to reduce waste and to save costs. So people might buy big 5 kilo sacks of grain or something. So rather than you going to the shop and buying 500 grams of rice in a small, you know, packet with loads and loads of plastic, and me doing exactly the same and someone else doing exactly the same, we club together, we buy a big sack of that. There's much less plastic, it's much cheaper than going to the supermarket and buying your 500 grams of rice. And then we split that up, so we've saved money, we've saved packaging, we've had a nice community experience because we've got to know each other a bit. So it's a way of bringing people together, it's a way of talking about food and a way of talking about other issues that concern us, and we're saving money and we're saving the planet in a very small way.
I mean, the Bevy pub, for example, has been a tremendously successful exercise.
Yeah.
Can you see that happening elsewhere as well?
Definitely, yeah, mm. yeah, definitely. That's happening all over the place, and there are plans for similar things happening in Brighton. There's quite a few murmurs of similar projects slowly setting up. In other parts of the country, it's happening all over. I think this is really the beginning of a very different way of looking at things.
The revolution is on the way.
Yeah, I hope so, yeah, certainly.
And the other one is alternative to energy.
Yeah, so energy...
Is that really the purchase of energy?
So energy co-ops can again operate in different ways, but people might try to actually set up an energy production system. So whether it's solar panels or wind farm or whatever, they might buy into an existing energy supplier as a co-op. We've got someone who's going to talk about energy co-ops at the event. Something
so you
that
buy
I'm,
wholesale and then pass that on?
Yeah. It's not my strong point, I have to say. It's quite a new development. There's going to be someone from Brighton and Hove Energy Co-op who's going to be talking about the event, who will be able to talk much more informatively than I can. Yeah. But all of these things, you know, there's bike co-ops, there are health co-ops, there are education co-ops. Anything in life we can approach in a cooperative way. So you can apply these principles to pretty much anything
we
do.
So literally just growing and anything goes?
It can be applied to anything, yeah, certainly, yeah.
But how do you take that away from the established suppliers? Although we haven't got much time to discuss that, I'm going to have you back when I talk about it again, I think, some of the time. Just remind people, the event is on the 11th of June. It's Mutual Aid in Sussex who have actually put this event on, and it's at the Synergy Centre at 78 West Street in Brighton. And it's been a pleasure meeting you, Matt.
Thank you. Thanks
for having
me. Thank you
very much, and good luck with everything you're doing.
Cheers.
I'm going to watch this with fascination, I think. I'm just going to say people like money at the same time. Nice to see you. All the best. See you again soon.